you ever come in with a complaint fewer than 100 pages?
Yes. Yes.
I haven't seen it in New York from Robbins Geller. I don't see it here either.
I understand the concern. We strive for under 50. We can't always get there. It's a demanding pleading standard. Good morning, Your Honor. Good morning, Your Honors. Susan Alexander for the Arkansas Teachers and the State of Boston Retirement Systems. And you're right. Given that this case was dismissed at the pleading stage, there's a surprising volume of materials. I would like to focus the court's attention on the strongest false statement. False statements. So the essential false statement here was that CEO Hastings told investors he had taken the risk out of the concern about streaming's rate of profitability. So Netflix is transitioning to a new business, streaming, and there are two statements, on December 8th of 2010 and December 20th of 2010. So the market was very concerned about the cost of streaming content, and on December 8th of 2010, in an earnings call, CEO Hastings responded to an analyst to express those concerns. Content's expensive. It's competitive right now to get licensing from the movie houses. How are you going to deal with that in terms of profit margins? And Hastings said, we manage the margins. We're not going to significantly overspend in terms of our content buying. That is a management discipline issue. If content were more expensive than we thought, we would have less total content for our fixed spending. The margins would be preserved. So, I'm sorry?
You feel that you couldn't make such a statement without having the ability to track profit and loss with respect to both sets of activities, DVDs and streaming?
I think that the most reasonable inference, to which we're entitled at the pleading stage, is that they must have had that. They would have had to have that reasonable basis in order to make that statement, yes.
Making a statement of profitability.
Yes.
You don't know if there's profitability or not is a misstatement.
Correct.
You can't say something is true if you don't know whether or not it's true.
Absolutely. I 100% agree.
Legally, you can't say something is true if you know that it's not true.
That's true. And
you're saying that this is a fair inference from your pleading.
I think it's a great inference. Yes. I think it's a very fair inference from the complaint. Yes. And
that's your whole case.
That's my whole case. And, well, there's actually a little piece more than that. Yes, that's most of the case. The little piece more is that what he said is, we control this. He said, we can't control growth, but we control margins.
And what does that mean?
It means that, so margins are profit margins, right? It's how much do you bring in and how much do you spend. And what he said is, I know, the risk here is that content has gotten really expensive. And so that's going to skew margins. And he said, we can control that piece of it. Profit margins will not ever manifest as a risk.
And what do you read from that? What's the necessary inference from that?
Actually, he articulated it. He said, if content were more expensive than we thought, we would have less total content. So what I understand from that and what the analysts understood contemporaneously was that they weren't going to spend so much on content that they would drive the streaming profit margin down to 8%, which is what was revealed at the end of the class period.
And that management had to know.
Yes.
They had to know their margins. At least they had to have some kind of estimate.
They had to have a reasonable basis in order to be able to speak. And they're
tracking separately profitability and streaming and profitability with DVDs.
Which is consistent with complaint allegations where CEO.
You're saying you're not doing it when you are doing it. Then you not only have a false statement, but Sienter as well.
Yes. CFO Wells said.
So we don't really care under your theory whether it was a mistake or not with regard to motions to open up a judgment or motions to amend. You're not going to have a better pleading than this. I mean, you can't have a better pleading. I take issue with pleading style. But you've alleged the facts that you need to allege.
Absolutely. And we can look. That's my position, is we can look at the allegations in the first amended complaint, which everyone agrees we reviewed de novo, and those allegations state a claim.
And so either Judge Cunningham was right or wrong with regard to his rulings on misstatements. We don't need to get into the issue whether you had opened up the judgment or not.
I agree. Yes. And the reason that I think Judge Conte misunderstood the case is Judge Conte somehow looked at the broad, the overall case as being a forecast of how streaming was going to do in the future.
I'm taken in by your opponent's argument about plausibility. And he was arguing, and this is another question, we have to follow a standard of plausibility. So how much discussion of the merits goes in on a pleading when there's an attack on plausibility?
I think the question is whether it's plausible, and the analyst's reaction contemporaneously shows that the plausible understanding of what they were saying is, we've got streaming margins. We've handled this. We're not going to overspend on content. And plausibility is enhanced by the fact that CEO Hastings says, we're spending 98% of our time on streaming. The annual report said, streaming is our core strategy. There's insiders selling over $86 million during the class period. So we have strong scienter facts that support the plausibility of falsity. But you don't even have to get there for the plausibility on falsity because we've just got a black and white. The market relied on it, absolutely. There was a 35% stock drop.
Your argument is that's the best test of plausibility. The market relied on the statements.
I think the statements themselves and the market's reliance are both strong indicators of plausibility. I mean, here, on falsity, it's pretty black and white. When you don't do what the district court did and sort of mingle in some kind of actual knowledge requirement for falsity, the falsity is simply, during the class period, they said, we're not going to overspend on content. We control margins. We've got this. And after, at the end of the class period, they revealed margins are only 8%, and they said it's
possibly measured that we're not going to overspend on content. Who could possibly judge that and say, well, this is false?
Except
as hindsight.
Because they were tracking it incredibly closely. It was their core business, and CFO Wells, they'd been looking at streaming only.
So we know that they did overspend on content.
What they said, what we know is that when they said they missed margins, the explanation they gave was, this is on October 24th, 2011. They said, it's due to our increased streaming content spend. So, yes, that plausibly suggests that they overspent on content. That's the explanation they gave for why profit margins were only 8% when during the entire class, one-year class period, they'd been saying, that's the one piece of this.
So a year later, you're suggesting that they did say that they may have overspent.
I'm saying that a year later, they had to admit that overspending on content was.
So the question is whether they knew at the time that they made those statements that they were going to overspend or that they had already overspent.
So.
But he says we're not going to overspend, and he knows he's overspent, that he would be lying. If he thinks he's not going to overspend in the future, and he says we're not going to overspend, that would not be a lie. It might turn out to be false in the future.
Or to Judge Hellerstein's point, if he doesn't know how content spending is going to affect streaming.
Yeah, but the statement is so general.
It's not. Because I'd like to refer you to the next statement. So he didn't just make the statement once in an earnings call. On December 20th of 2010, he repeated it. So an analyst wrote a report saying, you ought to short Netflix because this expensive content is really going to be a problem for streaming's profitability. And he wrote back to the analyst and said, he took this really unusual measure of writing. It's ER-254 is the letter itself, and it's in paragraph 164 of the First Amendment complaint.
Okay, so which paragraph? I'm on 254. So which
254.
Which paragraph? How does it begin?
Two paragraphs I refer you to. The 7th paragraph down, he says he's moving on to the widely discussed issue of increased content costs. And then in the next paragraph, first sentence of the next paragraph, he says, yes, investors sometimes see the content cost threat as an issue around our margins. We have no intention of overspending relative to our margin structure. There's no.
And you're saying that's a lie because they did intend to overspend?
We have to keep going.
Okay.
He says, if content costs rose faster than we expected, then in practice, we'd have less content than otherwise, rather than less margin. The last sentence, he says, management at Netflix largely controls margins. Not growth, but margins. And to Judge Hellerstein's point, if he didn't know, it's a false statement. In Reese, this court.
What precisely is it false?
The false statement is, we've got it. In this court's decision in Reese versus Malone, this court said.
That's just puffing.
It's not. It's not, because he lent an element of uncertainty.
It's only if he knows that he's not in control, the statement could be false.
No, and I'd like to read you this one sentence from Reese versus Malone, which I think explains it. He lent an element of certainty to a situation previously indicating risk, which is inherently misleading. So what the market was concerned about was content. And he didn't go to the market and say, you're right, this is kind of an unknown area, we're not sure what's going to happen. He said, we've got this. The one thing we can control is how much money we spend on content, and we're not ever going to overspend on content. At the end of the class period, the market finds out their explanation for why they missed is because they spent on content. It's their sentence, their words, due to our increased streaming content spend.
That's
at the pleading stage. No, it's a statement of present action. We do not, I understand, it's tricky, but he said, it is not going to ever manifest itself as a margin risk. This is not ever going to be a problem. This is what the market was worried about.
On the following page, he says, there are many risks ahead for Netflix. It's possible that one could make money shorting Netflix today.
Well, no, he's writing a letter back to this guy, to this.
Of course he is. He wants people to buy Netflix, not sell Netflix. He doesn't want them to short Netflix.
Sure.
But
he didn't say this is a.
There are risks here, and maybe you can make money, but I don't think so. That's exactly what he's supposed to do, but he hasn't said, we have a contract with Starz that they didn't have. He hasn't said that we've got, that our next quarterly earnings will be 25%, but he already knew what they were going to be.
What he said was, there's one piece of this that we can control, and that's how much we spend on content. And I can't tell you, what he said is, can't tell you what's going to happen with everything else, but we control margins. It's a management responsibility issue. He said they were going to control spending. If costs were higher than they expected, they just wouldn't buy the content. And that is a plausibly false statement at the pleading stage. We're at the pleading stage.
Is it the statement we believe that we can control margins?
No.
I know it's not there, but isn't it necessarily implied?
He used the word largely. He said we largely control margins.
On December 8th, he said.
The falsity I worry about is if you have the information and make a statement that is independent of the information, you are saying something that is untrue. You're saying something without giving more information that you have that would make it untrue. It's that second qualifying part of falsity in 10b-5.
Right.
But you're not focusing on that. You're saying the statement itself is untrue because it turns out that the margins were not controlled.
The statement, right. The statement
is not untrue. That really is a statement of prediction. Management says we control margins. We know nobody is in control of the world.
Not the world, how much money they spent. And if he didn't know, then Reese versus Malone says he didn't have a reasonable basis for making that statement to investors. If he didn't think he could control spending, if he didn't think he could control margins, then he didn't have a reasonable basis for telling investors that he could. He took a risk and made it into a certainty, which is, this court holds, inherently misleading.
No, he also said that he controls postage, that postage expense is dropping because there are fewer DVD sales and more streaming, and that money could be saved that way and save money and increase margins on streaming.
They're two independent businesses, right? So the spin they put on the fact that DVD business was going down and their subscription rates was, well, good news is we'll save the postage on those mailings, and so we'll put that into content spend. But again, that's doesn't take anything away from their ultimate statement, which is the content spend is not ever going to manifest itself as a risk because we control how much we spend. We control content spending. And then at the end of the class period, the investors who didn't know during the year find out that during that year they didn't control content spend, and that's why margins were only 8% for streaming.
Okay, you have about 40 seconds left.
Okay, let me reserve that for rebuttal. Thank you so much.
May it please the court, Keith Eggleton. I represent Netflix, Reed Hastings, Mary McCarthy, and David Wells. I'm going to start right at what counsel called her whole case. I want to talk about those statements about margin. A little bit of context for them first. One of the last things counsel said was that these were independent businesses. That was, in fact, not the case in late 2010. Netflix did not separate its DVD and its streaming business until 2011. It was
announced. Doesn't mean it's not tracking.
Pardon me?
That doesn't mean you can't track it. It doesn't mean you can't track it.
It doesn't track it. There's no question that the company could track many things about streaming. Hours watched, cost, the
revenues,
notes, respectfully profitability, respectfully not revenues. Because at that time, it's a while ago, but when people used to get the red envelopes, and that was the primary way Netflix was delivered, the vast majority, in fact, in October 2010, essentially all domestic subscribers, what were called hybrid subscribers, they both got the envelopes in the mail and they could stream, and they paid one price for both. So the vast majority of Netflix's revenue came through this hybrid plan where subscribers were paying for both. So in fact, revenue was not divisible between what counsel mistakenly called independent businesses. That did not happen until
that a matter of defense. Ireland defense. I mean, what kind of requirement is there in a pleading? If a pleading sets forth with some plausible basis that there is an ability to track, and you're saying there isn't an ability to track,
yes,
it becomes a denial and an issue of fact.
Respectfully, I don't think that's right here, because plaintiff's pleadings were candid in the fact that there was the hybrid plan until the plans were separated in July of 2011.
Management has the ability to make assumptions and have standard ways of looking at these things so that it can do a tracking. They have to be adjusted after the fact, but they can track.
They can. There's absolutely no question they can track many things about
that. Can't they allege that?
Well, can I go back a complaint?
I think I've taken you off the point.
No, that's okay. Let me talk about those statements in particular, the margin statements. Mr. Hastings absolutely talked about margins and said they had control over margins. What that meant was they had the ability to control their content spend. At that time, it was a combined business. They had cost of the mailers. That was one of their costs. And the other cost was content. And he was talking about the overall margins of the business. And counsel wants to say that was a false statement. They've never alleged here that statements Mr. Hastings made about the overall business, the overall margins of Netflix, were false or misleading. What they needed to say, and they tried to convince Judd Conte of this, that those statements had to do with the streaming business and just the streaming business. Mr. Hastings' statements?
The allegations of the complaint?
He certainly was speaking
to the gravamen of their complaint is that you did not separate and state the far lesser profitability of the streaming business than to let everybody to believe. You said it was one business. That's your attack on plausibility. And you didn't separate the numbers, and you couldn't separate the numbers. And they take issue with that, and they say that you could do it and did do it, and that it is false by not saying you knew that it was not working out the way you thought. That's their argument. They may be totally wrong, but that's their argument.
That is their argument. They have to state, in order to, they're pleading as an informational belief, they have to plead all the facts that suggest that Netflix had the separate profitability of standalone streaming to state their case under the PSLRA.
I think it's a reasonable inference in business that businesses know how to track numbers and know how to track activity, and where things look indivisibly, they assign certain percentages that are based on their best estimates and their experience. I don't see why that's a plausibility attack. It's a merits attack, not a plausibility attack.
Their case fairly stated would be that before Netflix, in the October-December 2010 time period, before Netflix separated the hybrid business into two separate businesses, to do that would have required a forecast. In other words, Netflix would have had to forecast a number of things. First of all, it would have had to decide that it was going to sometime in the future separate the plans, which it had not done, and it was not announced. It Second would have had to make an estimate about how many subscribers would go to each side. So when the plans were separated in 2011, subscribers all had to make a choice. They had to either go with the DVD plan or the streaming plan, or they could join both. They would have had to estimate that, and they would have had to estimate how much they would charge for each of the plans. If they had made that, all those estimates, they could have, I suppose, plausibly made a forecast of what streaming, a standalone streaming business profitability would be. But that is not, respectfully, I don't believe the law requires at that point them to make that forecast. Mr. Hastings was talking about controlling the margins of the overall business. Margins that, frankly, the plaintiffs don't allege that he couldn't do that with respect to the overall business. What they say is at the end, when the businesses were separated and Netflix then gave separate profitability for both sides of the business, somehow that made his statements from almost 11 months earlier false, notwithstanding the fact that they were about the overall business.
They're alleging that you knew, or had the basis to know, and that you were insane. Okay, I have your point.
I know the district court did not reach the scienter question, but I wanted to touch on it briefly because there was one point that we made throughout the briefing below, and because Judge Conte did not reach scienter, he didn't reach it. But the underlying theory of this case is that Netflix was somehow hiding the fact that content was expensive.
This is a statement from page 254 of the record. Because Netflix's subscriber base is growing fast enough and DVD shipments were growing slow enough that we can afford to pay for the existing streaming content we have and also get more content. That, to me, suggests that management had a pretty good idea of its numbers, and that meant it was tracking the numbers. And if it was tracking the numbers and made the statement independent of the numbers, then it's false. Now, it's plausible they had the numbers. I infer that from here. They may be totally wrong. Maybe they didn't have the numbers, but it's a merits point. It seems to me it's not a pleadings point. It should not be a place of a bar. The problem, I think, is that the complaint is not, it's long on information, but short on analysis.
Yep.
And we're not getting a good analysis, but that's a problem in pleading.
I want to respond directly to your point about numbers. There's no question they had numbers, and I think the statement you just read suggested they had DVD cost numbers and content cost numbers. No question. And in fact, we had decided in our papers, you'll see that Netflix told investors exactly how much they were spending on content. They put a chart in their SEC filings, which listed at one point during the class period $1.3 billion in commitments, and later 2.4.
What does it mean that you control our content if you know the costs?
Yep.
And you say you can control, that means you've got to make a measure. You make a measure against projected revenue. And therefore, if costs exceed a certain benchmark, you stop buying content. That's what they mean.
Correct.
Which means they had an idea of both revenue and costs.
There's no question they had an idea of overall revenue. No question. They did not have, and couldn't have until they separated that businesses, had an idea of what a streaming business revenue would be.
That's your contention.
I think it's
our right, it's not our even plausibility.
I believe it's established by the plaintiff's open pleadings in their complaint where they talk about the combination plan and what it was priced at, and then the fact that it was split the next year. And I believe it's their burden, especially under the PSLRA, to come forward with facts that Netflix had about what they say, which is the profitability of streaming. I want to go back to your point, though. There's no question they had numbers. And Mr. Hastings' statement, what he says is, we can control the content cost and our margins, which means we can decide how much to spend on content. The grander point he was making was that he goes on to say, if in fact we see our margins going down, what we'll likely do is spend less on content, which may have the result of reducing our subscribers because people won't want to join the service as much if the content offering goes down. So, in fact, frankly, it was plaintiffs make an affirmative statement as though it was some dramatic moment. What he was really saying was, we have a balance here. We can decide how much to spend on content. If we see our margins eroding, we'll spend less on content. But, oh, by the way, understand that might hurt us in subscribers. One point on Scienter, but it goes more broadly to the case. The case from the beginning was about the notion that the profitability of streaming was somehow withheld. The case started as a gap case. The first complaint, which plaintiffs did not appeal from, was that Netflix had the obligation to separately account for, under GAAP, the profit for the streaming business during 2010 and 2011. Judge Conte dismissed that because they didn't allege the facts about having profitability. The second complaint then became about essentially the same basic theory. You had to, instead of doing it under GAAP, now you had some general obligation to disclose the separate profitability. Netflix, what was ironic about the case and about the way it ended, was Netflix could have very well gone on with life and never disclosed the profitability of a streaming business. The only reason the profitability of the streaming business was ever disclosed, which here is the end of the class period, was because Netflix made the decision in July to separate the businesses. In other words, when it made the decision to separate it, then it had separate revenue and costs. And going forward, it was going to be required under GAAP to segment report for the two businesses. So the dramatic moment that plaintiffs want to say ended this class period was merely because they had separated the businesses. It was Netflix's forecast, which they weren't obligated to do, but they forecast for investors what the streaming business was going to be on a profitability basis now that it was separated. They separated in July. Subscribers had to pick which plan to go with in September. And in October, Netflix gave a forecast of streaming profitability. They would have never made that disclosure, and they would have never had to had they not decided to separate the businesses. In other words, they decided themselves to separate the businesses.
I don't think that's what they're alleging, and I don't think that's the gravamen of their complaint. You have a statement, December 8, 2010, by Hastings. There was no material financial risk in declining DVD sales because streaming is growing so fast. Those are statements of facts.
Yes.
Supposedly, there has to be numbers that support that. You can't say that unless there's a basis to say it. You have to have a reliable basis
correct.
To say that's
correct.
That means you've got numbers.
Yes.
And then McCarthy says the benefit of paying less on DVD is not higher profit margins. It creates an opportunity for us to retask that money with our studio partners in the licensing of streamed content, which accelerates the virtuous cycle. More content, more subscribers, more revenue. We don't care about DVD, but the streaming. Again, there's basis for it. And the reader of these statements, the listener to these statements, has the very divine notion that the money, the revenue streams are growing in the way that will expand profits. That's the gravamen of the complaint. And if you don't have the numbers, you can't say this. And if the numbers don't support it, you can't say it either.
Yes.
And that's what they want to do. That's what they want to pursue. And that makes, to me, a plausible statement that you have numbers and you haven't disclosed it. Therefore, what you say is false.
Those statements were absolutely about the transition. People are wanting the DVDs less. They're wanting to stream more. That was absolutely happening. And what those comments mean was
that was the basis of your business.
That was. It was absolutely driving revenue, no question. But profitability is a separate metric. But it was absolutely driving revenue. During this time period, Netflix membership was skyrocketing because people were starting to stream.
And would always have that growth because you can control costs.
Well, growth in revenue, you can only get growth in revenue if you add subscribers.
By having fewer content.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. If there are no more questions, I'm happy to submit.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Angleton. Ms. Alexander.
I'd like to quickly make 3 points. The statements, the complaint, definitely plausibly alleges the defendants had a basis for this knowledge. CFO Wells said, we've focused on streaming for 2 years. We've proved it out. And to be clear, the streaming-only plan in the United States began 1 month into this class period, November of 2010. There was also still other plans, but his streaming-only plan began 1 month into this class period. No question these guys had the numbers. Number two.
Let me ask you one question.
Yes, of course.
It just bothered me. As I've read through these various snippets in your complaint, it seems to me when I put these in context, I can't come up with what's going on in most of these. Am I to dwell specifically on December 8 and December 20?
I think those are the strongest statements, so I would say yes. Here's what I think about the other statements.
I want to review December 8 and December 20, but I'll tell you that as I read the complaint, well, frankly, as I read your brief, it seemed to me that you were taking statements, if you will, out of the Second Amendment complaint and trying to argue about them when they weren't in the first several times, which caused me some concern.
They're all in the First Amendment complaint. All of the fact statements are in the First Amendment complaint.
And once again, December 8 and December 20 is the major one.
But the other ones are as well. All the statements, and I can give you citations to the First Amendment complaint, and I, you know, apologize if there's confusion about that. They're cited in both complaints in the reply brief, but I can show you where they are. But I would say, as to those other statements, I agree with you. There's a range of statements, and any one of them on their own wouldn't be the basis for a securities fraud class action. I agree. But in combination, those statements gave investors an impression of certainty about the risk of streaming. And I've pointed you, the reason I've pointed you to the December 8th and the December 20th statements is because I think they're the strongest. But there's also a totality analysis to be done here, looking at the whole complaint. The totality of the circumstances, the overall expression of Netflix to its investors was, we've got it. We know you guys are really nervous about the cost of content for streaming. We've got it. We can control margins because we can control content spend. So we, for falsity.
Thank you. You've answered my question. You can go on with your other points.
Okay. I hope I did.
Well, yes, you can.
For falsity, our requirement under the.
All of your time, counsel. So you may want to. I'll allow you just a little bit to sum up here, but I think you want to sum up.
Okay. In summary, the statements during the class period were false, plausibly false, because they had said that they would control content, and at the end of the class period, it was revealed that they did not control content. And the scienter facts, which the district court never reached, are strong here. The 98% attention, the fact that this was a core strategy, the fact that they sold over $86 million worth of shares during the class period, as well as the stock buyback program, the debt deal, and avoiding questions twice from the SEC about what is going on with this business. Overall, those facts state a claim. Thank you, Your Honors.
Thank you. Thank you, counsel, for the argument. That completes the oral argument calendar. The court is in recess.